Thank you, Eugene, for that kind introduction. And Mr. Chairman, thank you very much for holding this very important hearing on a subject that affects the United States government and, more importantly, the very people we serve. If we really think about this at a macro level, there have been three major revolutions that now lead to the technology revolution. The first was the agricultural revolution. But in the agricultural revolution, if you think about the movement of people and the movement of capital, it was limited to essentially a 25 square mile. An individual could literally spend an entire lifetime with the means of production and distribution of food and distribution of goods. Then came the Industrial Revolution, as the chairman said, with trains and the ability to move goods and people at much higher velocities. And now, as we've entered the technology revolution, one of the things that's happened is we've fundamentally changed the way we interact with our government. If you look at the major innovations that have happened within the federal government and how we serve the American people, what we've been able to do as a result of broadband penetration across the country and the ability to engage the American people has changed permanently how we operate. Yet, there are too many people who are not able to participate. What I want to do is highlight a couple of things that we're doing within the United States government that are showing the idea of open government and democratizing data, how they're actually producing results. One of the big things that we're focused on is to simplify access to government services. And what underpins that is the digital infrastructure that powers our modern economy. One of the big problems we have is the ability to access some of these services in a way that allows people to, on a real-time basis, see how their government is performing, be able to participate, and actually move towards a participatory democracy. There are unprecedented opportunities as a result of some of the work that we're doing in terms of citizen participation, transparency and open government, how we democratize data. Two big phenomena that we're looking at is one is on the cloud computing side, which is how do we take the $76+ billion that the United States government spends today on information technology, and majority of that money is actually spent on integration services. How can we take advantage of some of the innovations that have happened in the consumer markets, where there's Darwinian pressure to innovate, and where we've seen massive gains in productivity that haven't been, unfortunately, matched within the federal government? Secondly, how do we look at agencies that have actually done a great job, such as the U.S. Patent and Trademark Office, to fundamentally change the way that agency operates? What I want to talk about is, from a participation perspective, the President talked about laying a new foundation, a foundation that's built on transparency and open government. One of the key things we did is, as we looked at the problem of optimizing and rationalizing the $76 billion that the U.S. government spends, we asked a very simple question, which is, how can we engage the American people to help us shape the way we spend that money and recognize the fact that the federal government does not have a monopoly on the best ideas out there? So what we decided to do is fundamentally change the way we're actually managing by engaging the American people. The old model was a very opaque, closed, exclusive model of managing $76 billion. It was very static, and there was faceless accountability. In 1994, there's a report issued by then Senator Cohen that talked about billions of dollars that are being wasted on information technology projects. Last year, there's a report that talked about $30 billion of IT investments that were in trouble. Yet, the reporting that was there was a management watch list, which is a static list that Congress, the GAO, and the administration issued. The President talked about a culture where we move away from secrecy, where we can change the default position of the federal government from secret to open and transparent. So what we did is we built a dashboard that would lift the veil on IT expenditures. As soon as we launched this public-facing dashboard, which exposed every layer of spending, from who was responsible for the project with actually the picture of the CIO on that project, so you could actually see who is running this project, which contractors are working on it, where we are in terms of milestones on that project. And we saw very quickly that we got over 43 million hits. There's this hunger for this information out there in the public domain. But not only that, we actually made sure that we created this platform so we could engage the American people in giving us ideas on how we could move the needle and find the innovative path as we invested in these IT projects. And what we saw quickly was a whole new model of looking at IT projects, to the point where also the Veterans Administration recently announced that it's temporarily halting 45 IT projects. One of the worst offenders out of those projects was a project that was 110% over budget and over 17 months behind schedule. And you can see, as we move forward, the CIOs that were not really looking at these projects historically and analyzing them, we set a deadline and we announced it publicly that within 30 days they had to evaluate every single project. And as you can see from that chart, we've hit that mark. And the public was calling, the Congress was calling, the GAO was calling and asking each of the CIOs where they were and the Office of Management and Budget. What that led to is better governance in terms of what we're doing. But this is one model, and it's going to take a lot of hard work to move in that direction. We also made sure that we democratized the data so people could actually slice and dice and give us different views of risk across the board. We allowed people to actually take any of the projects they're interested in. If you're interested in public health or education or energy, you could embed those projects on Facebook or Twitter or on your own personal blogs. So we essentially created communities as a function of releasing that data and allowing the public to participate. Every day now, CIOs are getting new ways of thinking about these problems, and it's not limited to just the federal workforce. And we're looking at new and innovative ways of approaching this problem. Another area, thinking more broadly, is around democratizing data across the board. We embarked on an initiative called data.gov that would release as much of the public data as possible, recognizing that there is information that's classified or sensitive in nature. As of now, we've got over 100,000 data feeds from every aspect of government operations, from how the FAA is looking at flights, the average times delays across the country, to toxic release data from the EPA, to data from our healthcare system, Medicare and Medicaid. And what we're finding very quickly is that innovation is happening in the market as a result of democratizing this data. Within 24 hours of launching this, the Sunlight Foundation actually launched a competition called Apps for America and issued over $20,000 to anyone that would develop applications based on data.gov. What we saw immediately were a number of applications that were created. An example is flyontime.us, where an enterprising developer essentially took the data that the FAA had put out and created an application that would allow you and I to map out from one city to another the average delay times of flight so we could make a better decision where we want to book. But not only that, but we issued a challenge to CIOs across the country for every state and local government to create a data.gov so that for the first time you'll be able to now see what's happening across our transportation grid, or for that matter, broadband. So you could actually think about comparing whether it's cell phone plans or thinking about where you have broadband deployment and where you don't and what's the delta there, to applications that are being developed where the intersection of multiple data feeds allows us to see spikes or disparities in terms of what's happening as far as health outcomes, or if we're looking at how we can address some of the toughest problems that this country faces today. When it comes to broadband deployment, though, what we're seeing in the federal government is there are some agencies that have led, some because they were looking at broadband and teleworking as a mechanism to drive productivity and essentially make sure that they're attracting the best people, and others that were reacting to adverse circumstances. So the Patent and Trademark Office is a perfect example where you have a federal agency that's got a program in place where close to 50% of the employees are actually teleworking. And the PTO, USPTO, will tell you that they're already seeing over $2 million in cost savings and 14,000 tons of carbon emissions that have been saved. The other example I'd like to highlight is the GAO. After September 11th, the GAO had to vacate its building because of the anthrax attack at the Senate Hart building. And as a function of that, they had to come up with a solution in terms of how do you continue the operations of the United States government in that environment. And the employees there actually turned to teleworking. And what's really important as we think about this and the mission of the United States government across the board, from the Forest Service to NASA to Department of Defense, we're also as a government consumers of the technology that's deployed out there in the consumer space. And it's very important for us to be able to leverage that in times of great need. As a matter of fact, as a policy, as we think about the very nature of work in the 21st century. What I'd like to close with is just talk about the huge opportunity and the importance of the great work that you're doing here today. As we think of healthcare and education, and we think about fundamentally changing and introducing disruptive technologies across the board, we have an imperative to make sure that communities that are not able to access broadband or are not able to access the global economy and the digital world are disenfranchised. And what we need to do is redouble our efforts to make sure that we have an infrastructure across the country that will allow us to take this nation to the 21st century. Thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to speak, and I look forward to the discussion.
Great. Thank you, Vivek. We now hear from Graham Richard, who is the former mayor of Fort Wayne, Indiana.